As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way and who.
Greetings, New York Conference. How I wish we were meeting physically in person so that we could shake hands and hug and raise our voices in song without wearing masks and not wonder who is and who is not fully vaccinated. Alas, while that day is coming, it has not yet arrived, but it will. If it's God's will, and if we heed the guidance of health officials following recommendations established by scientists, then next year in 2022, we will gather on the shores of Lake George at the Silver Bay Retreat Center. Because we have such a need to be together, we're planning the older version of the annual meeting with a pre-retreat starting on Thursday and going all the way through a closing worship on Sunday. And we will sing, and we will hug, and perhaps we will even dance. On March 19th of 2020, I convened a meeting of the conference ministry team and presented them with what I foresaw as the stages of this terrible pandemic. Remember, this was when Governor Cuomo was on TV every day at 12 noon, when news sources were reporting about body bags and freezer tractor trailers in New York City. Even the pandemic of 1918 could not have prepared us for what we were about to experience. My private expectation was a six-month disruption of life at the most, after which we would essentially return to life as usual. What I did not and could not account for was the gravity of this virus, its variations, and that, coupled with the political turmoil in our country, resulting in the attack on our Capitol on January 6th, and the significance of the murder of George Floyd on May 25th, 2020. Perhaps if we were not sequestered in our homes and in front of our television sets, that murder may have gone unnoticed like so many lynchings that have taken place in this country over hundreds of years. But this was different. All of these things have contributed to a stressful pandemic unlike anything we've experienced before. Thanks to Reverend Henderson and Charlene Apsel from Practical Resources for Churches, we were able to assist a significant number of churches with setting up online worship and online giving. What had previously been resisted because it was perceived as too complicated became a necessity. And you did it. The conference ministry team was extremely impressed with how quick so many churches were able to make the change to live streaming or broadcasting recorded worship. And I want to add that so many were up to the task of creating high quality online services, learning from mistakes and constantly improving. Kudos to you. Job well done. And even those who did not transition to online worship found creative ways to communicate the good news of Jesus Christ and to care for the community. You have all been awesome, simply awesome. I'd like to share with you a slide that I shared with the staff on March 19th. The three phases I predicted were discovery, transition, and recovery. The items highlighted in green, I think I nailed on the head. For the items highlighted in yellow, I think the jury is still out. And the items in gray, I don't think I got right at all. I privately predicted that 20% of our churches wouldn't survive. Thank God I was wrong. Faithfulness to transitioning to online giving and continued contributions to support our ministry using the good old US Postal Service has been inspirational. That, together with the number of churches that applied for and received the government PPP loan/grants, resulted with most churches as the conference not experiencing financial devastation. While some churches were hit financially, a very small handful actually have closed permanently. We are now in the recovery stage of this awful pandemic, and history has not yet written how we have all fared. Do we have new visions for church? I'm not sure. Are we embracing resurrection living? I'm going to say more about that in just a bit. There are some very clear lessons that we've learned from COVID and perhaps because of COVID. First, we really love being together. It's a hardship for our souls when we cannot sing together. Community is an essential part of life. We have also learned something that I pray we will not lose. And that is, we can lessen our carbon footprint for the sake of healing the planet. Many businesses are evaluating right now if they will ever fully return to the old model of office space. Maybe they're motivated by the financial bottom line of savings on building maintenance and staff travel, but regardless, our reduced consumption of carbon fuels during the transition phase of the pandemic has been extremely important. The recent surge in air and automobile travel for me is very troubling. If churches will continue with hybrid worship, may we do so not so much because it is convenient for some, but rather because it blesses the earth to burn less carbon-based fuel. Yes, we are in a recovery phase, but we are not yet recovered. This is not over. To use a religious metaphor, it's as if this is late on Saturday, and we believe that Easter Sunday is going to dawn, but it's still Holy Saturday. We still have fears. The words Delta variant are anxiety provoking. We watch with uneasy eyes what is happening in India and Brazil. And when our children return to school this September, it will be with both relief and trepidation. We must not doubt that the ripples of COVID-19 will linger for at least a generation, if not longer. Easter will come, but it's still Holy Saturday. I'd like to shift focus to what I consider the gravest concern we should have as the New York Conference: blatant and systemic racism. Our New and Right Spirit anti-racism and white privilege awareness program has worked diligently. Kudos to Reverend Dr. Marsha Williams and Reverend Gary Smith, our conference anti-racism consultant. Before and during COVID, they have led awareness trainings from Syracuse to Saratoga Springs, from Binghamton to New York City. But let us not deceive ourselves. In our fight to eradicate racism, we have not even made it yet to Holy Saturday. We're still on the cross of Good Friday. early in the COVID crisis, Reverend Edney Stille and Reverend Dr. Williams convened a few Zoom gatherings specifically for pastors of color. We knew how important this was because COVID disproportionately impacted communities of color right at the same time when the news of George Floyd's murder took place. Black Lives Matter demonstrations were being infiltrated by anarchists and perhaps others with nefarious motives. And we saw as a result, the leader of the free world condemning our right to protest. For me personally, the lowest moment of 2020 was when the president ordered Capitol Police to disperse legal demonstrators so that he could have a photo op holding a Bible in front of an Episcopal church. For those who look like me, we cannot take any comfort in the discomfort that episode caused us. We cannot be comfortable when the pandemic of racism is endemic and systemic in every corner of American life, including the progressive American religious communities. We were already aware of the microaggressions that Reverend Palmer, Reverend Dr. Williams, and Reverend Edney Stille had experienced with churches in our conference. Those meetings with clergy of color only emphasized how widespread this experience was. In response to a letter I received and subsequent meetings with the Metro Black Clergy Group, our ministry team, with the help of Reverend Smith, Reverend Edney Stille, Reverend Ferner, and the leadership of Reverend Dr. Williams, created what we called the Welcoming Diversity Inventory, which for the purpose of this context, I will refer to simply as the inventory. This is not to be confused with the tool that had already been created called the Racial Diversity Assessment, which we will call the assessment. The assessment is something the New York Conference created in 2019 as a congregational tool to specifically assess congregational attitudes towards race and congregational practices that may promulgate systemic racism in the daily life of our UCC churches. In 2018, the annual meeting of the New York Conference passed a resolution declaring ourselves an anti-racism conference. It called upon our churches to utilize the assessment. Now, before it was created, we referred to the envisioned tool as an audit, but found that that term did not adequately describe the product, which is now our copyrighted assessment. The ministry team and the conference board have been profoundly disappointed with how few congregations have requested the use of the assessment, which equips a congregation with resources to create an individualized plan to root out systemic racism in our churches. I'll return to the assessment shortly, but I want to turn to what we have learned from the inventory. The Welcoming Diversity Inventory was designed specifically for congregations beginning a pastoral search process. It surveys attitudes toward many types of pastoral diversity, LGBTQIA+, female, male, non-binary identification, differing physical and mental abilities, ethnicity, and race. As I said earlier, the inventory was specifically the result of feedback from clergy who experienced congregational life that was not welcoming of the diversity that they embody. The inventory is a tool to help congregations avoid conflict after they call a pastor, as well as possibly identifying some areas of congregational life in need of being discussed and addressed. The result of the inventory are not part of the church's profile. No results are shared with any other entity other than the congregation itself. There are very few incidences in our congregational relationship where the conference can require a congregation to do something. But search and call policy is one of them. The staff brought the inventory to the conference board of directors and requested that they act to make it the policy of the New York conference that for a New York church ministerial position to be listed on the UCC Opportunities website, they must have completed the inventory and the mandatory private conversation regarding what the inventory results showed about welcoming attitudes of that congregation. Only 5 of the 19 questions in the inventory specifically mention race. We learned a lot from this. More than a few of the initial churches asked to complete the inventory responded with very strong negative pushback. When asked what was the source of their discomfort, all responded by saying they felt that the conference was labeling them as racist. None said that they felt that they were being accused of homophobia or sexism or ableism. It was only the 5 of the 19 questions about race that generated strong reactions. Further, the reactions came from the members of congregations that hadn't even completed the inventory yet. The pushback came from congregations of varying sizes located in all corners of the state. One Zoom meeting set up to discuss the negative feelings about the inventory only resulted in a conversation containing multiple microaggressions toward staff members of color. These concerns were brought back to the conference board of directors, which, after much prayerful and thoughtful conversation, decided to keep the inventory as a requirement of the New York search and call process. However, the board asked Reverend Dr. Williams if she would be willing to interview clergy and laity of color in New York that had experienced microaggressions and compile a confidential video and written statements describing these incidences. This was a confidential report shared only with the conference board members. I believe it's fair to say that the reaction of the white members of the board was that of surprise, sadness, and a deeper commitment to end racism. And this was manifested in 3 decisions the board made. First, the conference board of directors, the personnel committee, and all staff members participated in 5 hours of anti-racism training in early June. Second, the board asked staff to create a task force to bring to them a strategic plan on what needs to be done for this conference to fully live into our commitment to be an anti-racism conference. And that work is now underway. And third, the board committed to ongoing anti-racism training for themselves in order to dive deep into the realities of systemic racism in the church. The reason I have shared this much detail with you is because we, the white membership of the United Church of Christ in New York, may have believed that given the progressive tendencies of the state and the conference, we didn't suffer greatly from the sins of racism. We may be lulled into false assumptions. sisters, brothers, siblings in Christ, we have much difficult work to do. Our resolution to be an anti-racism conference has only begun to touch the surface of how widespread embedded systemic racism is in our beloved United Church of Christ. The 2018 resolution is akin to turning the knob even before opening the door where we need to go in order to end racism. It cannot be our goal simply to have our church participate in anti-racism training. It cannot be our goal to simply more fully fund the New and Right Spirit Ministry. We can take no relief in only educating ourselves about the difference between micro and macro aggressions in church and society. We cannot rest after we have received anti-racism education. The realm of God does not call us to understand racism. It calls us to end racism. And that work begins with the person we see in the mirror. Anti-racism training may only get us to Holy Saturday. Only ending racism will welcome the new resurrection living of an Easter people. There are only two of our associations, Metro and Oneida, that have mandated anti-racism training for their clergy as a requisite to maintaining ministerial authorization akin to boundary training. That's less than 20% of associations and clergy in this conference. We have offered several online book studies on Zoom that address racism in our society. And while they have been very well attended, it is a bit disturbing for the ministry team to see so many of these attendees not coming from New York UCC churches. Only three of our 250 plus UCC congregations in New York, three, Plymouth Syracuse, Presbyterian New England in Saratoga Springs, and Poughkeepsie Congregational, have done the educational work that our resolution called for. We have a long way to go, New York, and no box gets checked off when the training is done. Again, the goal is not anti-racism training. The goal is ending racism, period. Before I conclude this address, I'd like to make a few comments regarding our Called to Serve God capital campaign. It's been a pleasure and an honor to partner with the pension boards. Their leadership and support continue to be essential. I thank committee members, J.K. Boodley, Lucy Werner, Donna Roll, Kelly Rogers, Ralph English, Yvette Wynn, and Ryan Henderson. And I also thank the several solicitors who have done the essential work of asking for pledges. This has not been easy work. We are not where we'd like to be, despite several very generous gifts. The current ministries of this conference have been designed in faith that a successful capital campaign would undergird the ministry for years to come with an endowed fund. We will get there, but like so much in this State of the Conference address, we're not there yet. We need your support. Please make your personal pledge. And please discuss with your congregation a special gift for the establishment of this endowed fund to ensure the health of the future of the church. And finally, I want to thank our staff. Figuring out even how to do conference ministry during a pandemic is hard enough, but to jump into it with creativity and energy and sustaining that, even when our own creativity and energy was challenged in so many ways, has been inspiring. Speaking only for myself, this has been the most difficult year, the most challenging year of my 33 years of ministry. If it were not for the talented and dedicated staff members, I really don't know where we would be as the United Church of Christ in New York. Thank you, staff. Thank you, Donna and Judy and all conference board members. You have been wise, hardworking, and steadfast. You have also been faithful and prophetic. I began by thanking the work of our clergy during unprecedented times, and that's where I will end. When we could not open our doors, you, the clergy of the New York Conference, opened yourselves to new ways of ministry, ways that lead all of us to more fully become people of resurrection living. Let it be so.